will try to motivate my students and colleagues also. So kindly be in home and take proper precautions and motivate others to be in home and be positive. Positive attitude, I mean. And however, I would confess that my all family were in exposed to the COVID. But with the love and affection of you all, I could be out. And in the meantime, our expertise also in he has faced all, and I think now just he has recovered.
Yes, sir.
So, and he is one of my best student and a friend too. It's very nice to see him healthy, and I wish. We remain healthy in this pandemic and so long. Gentlemen, it's time to be together in family and in society. And also, this pandemic taught me one more lesson, that how much disciplined you are. This is a test of discipline, how much you can be confined, how much you can control, how much you can be inside your room, and how being at one place, you motivate others and be motivated. Unless you have a zeal to go ahead, you will face a problem. And try to take all precautions, but be motivated as a most of us are mechanical, and be like joist, like steel rolled rather than tempered. Nothing will happen. This pandemic will go off. Objective, we are together, and we are. Gitansu, you are looking like something like Ulta Chasma. So, now, I would like to introduce my speaker for the day. And Mr. Satish is very, you can say, one of the intellectual and you can say very sober, full of knowledge and exposed to the world. I think somebody has a speakers on, so kindly you can switch it off, and later I will also switch off my camera. And he is with me more than I think 10-15 years. So, and I have seen him from very beginning, from BJ to this place, and you can say one of the fine outcome of mine is Satish, and definitely he will give you one, you can say, the best part of his knowledge. One more thing is the material testing and characterization is one of the biggest challenges for a manufacturing section. And he is working in this, in the one of the, you can say, excellent environment in the power grid. So you will be very fortunate to take his knowledge, enjoy his knowledge. And I will call Dr. Satish to take your mic on and share your views and knowledge with our students. Satish, yes, please.
Good afternoon, sir. Thanks a lot for nice introduction. And I am thankful to Technological Institute of Textile and Science and especially Abhay sir for giving me opportunity to share my view during this lockdown. And I'm happy to share my view and interact with the students. And so we can start with the presentation.
Sure, yes, you can. Vikas sir, can you hear me? Vikas sir, can you hear me?
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, good afternoon. And, okay, gentlemen, join immediately, and we are now formally going to start our webinar. So, Satish, please start.
Yes, sir. I have shared one presentation. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sure. Yes, it's visible. Is it visible?
So, is it in full screen mode?
No, it's you put F5.
Yeah, I've already done. I think it's taking some time delay. Now it's coming, sir.
All right.
In full screen.
No, it's not.
अभी भी फुल स्क्रीन नहीं है सर.
अभी फुल स्क्रीन नहीं है.
So I'm sharing again.
नहीं, आप एक काम करें सर. Please press the F5. F5 button.
Yeah, I have F5. Already pressed F5. In my screen, okay. It's showing.
Your cursor movement is visible here, but screen is not full screen, sir. So please.
Okay.
Share it again.
So I will share my screen in that case.
Yes,
I will
do that. Please.
Is it coming now in full
yes,
screen
sir.
Mode?
Yes, what is yes. Full screen mode?
Yeah. So I think most of the students are from BTech or
yes, sir.
Except. Okay. So we will start with the presentation. So the today's topic is advanced material characterization. And so I will share the view on different techniques. What are the different techniques nowadays we are using for the characterization of material? And more or less, I will give focus on the application part, because a measurement part for BTech may be slightly, because in deeper we give a 6-month course or so, but for application part it will be more interesting. So with the starting, we go with the advancement. So we discuss the advancement. So here I have put some pictures. So it shows that different images shows the Alto 800. So that initial picture shows the image of the 1980 Alto. So here we say that what is the development in this material or say technology or design. So continuous advancement is going on. So first image shows that more or less design is slightly straight, and we see that with the progress of the time. So second image is around 2000, and third image showing 2015, and this is the latest to 2021. So from design, we clearly see that the shape of the vehicle is changing. And also, of course, it's changing the efficiency and other parameters and designs. So one of the input we discuss here today is that material play important role for the shaping, because initial material development was not that much, and designs and everything was straight, because forming was a limitation for the materials. With the advancement in the characterization technique and new material development, forming has been advanced, and crystallographic texture controlled is possible through the various thermomechanical processing. So nowadays, designers are coming with the different designs which have the different curvatures. We can see in the last image, sharp curvatures are there, and material is not showing any crack or any rupture of the paints. So that is because of the material developments. Similarly, one more example is for the Ambassador we see. So that is the oldest one, we see 1980 or 1960. And new one is the concept. It is proposed. I'm not saying that it converting to the same design, but it is proposed like that DC design. So it may be electrical, but here also the one thing from the technology point of view, we can note that it's showing that the different curvatures and the joining of the different materials. We don't see any linkage between, but it's showing a smooth curvature and we can join the different materials because nowadays our technologies are there by which we can join the different materials and whether it is forming, whether it is forging or it's welding. So we can do the different kind of processing on the materials. Not only the automobile portion, we can take the example, one of more example I've taken the multidisciplinary kind of things, that is power transmission. So here we see that a older tower. So this tower shows that the typical tower which we have seen that older lines, and most of the tower in India are like 4-leg towers. And also the tower of the transmission as well as the tower for the telecom communication, we see similar structures are there. And new development of the materials and the technology designs, everything combines, it's brought out to the new design. It shows the single pole. So it saves the environment, it saves the space required for that. So agriculture space can be saved by that. So it all together give the combination of multidisciplinary, like civil, mechanical, electrical, materials, environment, all together develop continuously. But material is common for all these things. So nowadays material with the high strength, high malleability are available. And corresponding, we need to develop the technique to characterize the material properties so that we can identify and use the proper material at proper place. So with this, I will show one more example, which shows that processing, how we correlate the mechanical or metallurgical properties in the final shape of the product. So this diagram shows the interrelationship. So starting with the composition, first one. So initially, if we take any kind of example, whether it is electronic material, or it is a automobile, or it is a power sector material, all these starting with the chemical composition, we fix up the chemical composition. Then we process it through the different route, with the requirement of the hot forging, cold forging, or mechanical hot working or cold working. And we shape into final product. But in between, because of this processing, the properties developed in the materials are texture and microstructure. These are the driving properties which are developed. It's a combination of the composition plus processing. These two parameters drive the texture and microstructures. And as per one of the study in 1987, it shows that texture and microstructure in the materials can enhance or change the property in range of 20% to 50%. Though we are keeping the chemical composition same, but texture and microstructure itself can deviate the property by 20 to 50% of the material. And one of the example correlating with the grain size and mechanical properties, that whole well-known famous Hall patch equation is there. So that I kept for, because most of the student may be from mechanical engineering background, so we can understand better mechanical and microstructure correlation. So these two pictures shows that one has the smaller grain size and second one is the coarser grain size. So this shows that microstructure effect on the strength of material. So coarser grain size means bigger grain size has the lesser strength, and fine grain have the more misorientations and smaller grains are there. So this relationship itself tells that the strength of material is inversely proportional to the diameter. square root of the diameter, it's showing. So depending on the microstructure, showing the mechanical properties. So with this, we have to find out the different techniques by which we can identify the material and we can use on the different applications. Because now we have seen that example, it's a relation of the microstructure with the mechanical properties and our requirement with the different field, whether automobiles and power transmission or even the electronic media. We see that different kind of say laptops or different materials are coming. So for these, we need advanced characterization technique. So in characterization technique, I have identified some main areas. There are different other techniques are also, but out of them, I have selected main four characteristics. So in characterization, we take main microstructure, that is studied by scanning electron microscope. There is variety of scanning electron microscope that is equipped with electron dispersive spectroscopy, electron backscatter diffraction, that is EBSD. Next one is crystallographic texture analysis or say crystallographic analysis, that is performed by X-ray diffraction. Third one I have selected is thermomechanical or say chemical or analysis. So it's a combination of mechanical, thermal, chemical, all these combining we can characterize the material and final desired property can be obtained as per the requirement of designers. So starting with one by one, we can see that a microstructure with the scanning electron microscope. So microstructure technique, there are various kind of microstructure techniques which provide the different studies. So starting with the optical microscope, that is easily available and we have studied. So that is a, in older days was best which we can get, and it provides the various information, but there are some limitations, and with the advancement we are going to the new or better equipments. So first one is polarized optical microscope. It is best, but it's a quantitative. There are some limitation of the degree, 5 degree resolution. And with the progress of the developments we are going, so that red one is showing that BKD, EBSD and OIM. So it is the main theme we will be discussing today, that is orientation image microscopy. So it has a higher resolution, 1 degree. This is boundary resolution, and 0.1 micrometer is the resolution, and it's a optimum kind of technology. There are a PEM, that is a transmission electron microscope, are existing in this nowadays in technology, but these equipments are more sophisticated and they provide the very localized information, that is only a pinpoint we are getting, so statics of the data is limited. So going to the TM is more precise and it will give more accurate, but there is a limitation of the statics. So optimum solution is that orientation image microscopy using the electron backscatter diffraction. Also we use a scanning electron microscope. So basically it is a scanning electron microscope equipped with the two detectors, that is EBSD and OIM. So first I will show some slide to just give the glimpse of how equipment is visible and how it's working. Then we will discuss some applications, that how we can utilize it into practical engineering. So this picture shows the schematic diagram of the electron microscope. So these are the different kind of lens, electromagnetic lenses are used in this. And this one shows the chamber, and in chamber we have stage where we kept the sample. So from the top, we have two kind of guns, maybe the tungsten or some machine have field emission gun. So from the field emission gun, electron beam, that is a concentrated electron beam, is incident on the sample, and different kind of information are revealed from the sample. So in this lower picture, we see that different kind of signals are observed because electron beam interact with the sample, and when it after interacting with the sample, it take the information of sample and some signals are coming in the backward direction. So that we called backscatter diffraction. And in case of a TM, TM is also working on the same platform. So that also utilize the electron beam, but there is sample thickness is very thin, in say we can say in 100 micron or less than that, so that the electrons are transmitting from the sample. So that is called transmission electron microscopy. But here today we are discussing with the scanning electron microscope with the electron backscatter diffraction. So in the back direction electrons are coming, that signal we are capturing with the help of EBSD detector and EDS detector, which provide the detailed information of the sample. This is again schematic diagram which shows that a different kind of optics and the transmission of the ray, and how we focus the electron so that we can focus on that, and on the back focal we get the image of the object. And more or less more than image, using the EBSD we get the orientation of the crystals, how crystals are oriented in the material. So that also I will show later in the presentation, so that we can understand that how electrons and the crystallographic analysis we can perform. This image shows that schematic of a equipment. So this shows the beam control panel. This one is stage, and here we are seeing that the EBSD detector. So this one is EBSD detector, and this detector utilizes the electron which are coming in the backscatter direction. So backscatter electrons are superimposed and they form the Kikuchi bands. So these lines which we are seeing that are called Kikuchi bands, and these bands are formulated, and by simulated patterns these bands are superimposed and matched with each other, and a particular crystallography orientation is assigned. So this shows the incident electron in SEM that are forwarded to sample, and backscattered electrons are coming. So Bragg diffraction condition, that is a well-known equation. There is n lambda equal to 2d sine theta. So whenever this equation is satisfied with the different planes, so we'll get a superimposed interference, and that will form a these Kikuchi bands. These bands are Kikuchi bands. With these bands and simulations, this is showing that the different patterns simulated at the different rotations. So these rotation and these are completely automated. So there are programs which take care of that. User has to just put the sample and specify the different measurement condition and specify the area, and we get the different orientations. So we said that here different crystal orientations are shown. So these crystal orientations are assigned depending on the patterns. So according to the crystal orientation, we get the different database. So we can say that we get a Excel sheet, comma separated files, which has the different orientation angles. So that is called the Bunge angle or Euler angles, phi 1, phi, phi 2 in the terms of that. So three angles we get, and by that we can get the orientation of crystals. And for the utilizations, there is a color coding has been formulated, which assigns the different color to the different orientations, means we get the colorful microstructure. So now I'm coming to the application part, because in measurement part may not be that much useful, or that because only limited knowledge is required, because if we need to go in specific field, then there is a specific training and we can go to this one. Otherwise we can give the sample to the particular lab and we can get these results. So I will discuss more on the result part. So in the laboratory, that in BTech first year or to final year, we see that different kind of testing we perform in the mechanical testing lab. Like at my time, we have done compression of a brick and tensile test, and shear also we performed. So similarly, I think that most of the students have performed the shear or the tensile test. So we see that physically we see in sample there is changes happening, that it's fracturing and breaking. But inside material, what is happening, that today we will discuss. So in this image, we are seeing that a sample which shows a red box. So this is a sample to perform the shear test. So we can press the sample from the top, and this corner will be shear off that box portion. So the microstructure, this image shows the initial before fracture, and after shearing of the sample, we see that how microstructure or grains are changing. So here we see that completely grain structure in the terms of grain refinement. It has crushed the grain so that grain size is significantly reduced. So it's coming in the range of these few micron. And also we see that bands. So these particular bands. So not only this characterization tells that we can study the microstructure of the shear band, but it also tells that shear is a process by which we can refine the grains. So for the development of the new items or say new product, we can utilize the shearing process. So shearing process will give us the refinement of grains, and we have already seen that by refining the grains, we can improve the strength of material. So we want to improve the strength of material, we can utilize this in the process of the production. And for the commercialization, and these nowadays is similar to this application, is the ECAP, that is equi-channel compression. In that material is compressed and passed through a 90 degree die so that it completely shear off and its grain refinement is taking place, and we can get the better properties of material as per the requirement. Next application is from the automobile. So it shows the engine block. So engine block has the specific properties of material required for that, because it's heating and also the strength, because the compression is taking place in the piston, and it put a higher thrust on the surrounding. So we require a material property which is free of the defect and also have the high strength at the time of the, also observe the heat and take care of everything. So in this image, we see that the different defects are visible, that porosities are there, and these porosities are very fine. See the thing, 300 micron and 50 micron. So these porosity we can see at the resolution of scanning electron microscope. But when we want to see that more advanced phases are there, that phases are called precipitated phases, which are formed due to precipitate formation. And that precipitate phases forms in the material and increase the material properties in terms of strength. But by using this technique, we are not able to visualize this. So we need to go to submicron or say nanometer technology, that is transmission electron microscope. So this image clearly shows that Q phase and theta phase. So here we see that precipitated microstructure is formed, and we can say that this material will be having the that much properties or requirement is meeting as per the requirement of design. So such kind of critical studies we need to perform at the starting of a new designs. So these are not the used for the daily routine test, but whenever there is a new engine development is going on or new material is utilized, so some new design is coming. So in that beginning of that, usually in the industries, R&D take out that project and some studies was carried out, whether it is meeting. So then material is passed and that used for the production. So these kind of studies we can utilize in the industry. And this example is for the one of the material used in the missiles and that rockets. So this is a alloy that is called copper niobium alloy, and in which a tin has been mesh. So it is a kind of a mixing of the alloy. So the base is the red, this red one is the matrix of the copper, and in which niobium wire of the 5 micron and less than that, that has been extruded along with the copper. So challenge was that during the heating, there should be one specific phase formation that is called NB3SN. So that yellow portion is showing NB3SN, and during heat treatment, it should diffuse around the niobium. So in the right side image, we see that yellow color is formulated around red color. So that niobium has been diffused. So it is a niobium and tin NB3SN phase has been formed, and that phase formation was studied with the EBSD. So this phase is showing that elemental analysis with the microstructure. So this colorful phase is showing the elemental distribution in the microstructure. So the color coding showing the copper is red one, and the green niobium, and yellow is NB3SN. So with the useful that using the electron backscatter diffraction and combination of the energy dispersive spectroscopy in the scanning electron microscope, we can also study the how elements are distributed in the material along with microstructure. And this is one of the example application that is a small experiment performed in the laboratory level. So it's showing that the formation like that in the starting slide, we have discussed with the example of Ambassador and the today's car, which are coming now. So in that we see that a forming diagram. So how curvatures are forming, and there should be no curve. Crack should be formation. So in this setup, we see that it is a small setup that is made in the laboratory. So here we can put this small sample and we can screw it. And then this is a pushing. So we can using like a die setup. So with the help of this die and punch, we can formulate the material. So this is called a forming limit diagram. So in the mechanical, or we say that a kind of sheet metal forming. So when you go to industry of the sheet metal forming, they have very much interested in the forming limit diagram. So these forming limit diagram can be formed with the three shapes, that is square shape, then it's rectangular, and then it's rectangular with the lesser width. So these three shape samples are used, and these are formed in the different depth. So with the forming, there should be no crack. So that is the criteria for the car body sheet metal parts. So here we have studied the same area, means on the same area we have observed before deformation and after deformation. So this image shows the orientation. This is a boundary of two grains. So in this image, we can see only two grains are there, yellow and green. So we have selected only two grains and we have started deforming the materials. So in the books, we have seen that there are slip bands and shear bands we have studied in the theoretical, but we have not seen in. So in this picture, we can see that these shear band and slip bands are clearly visible. In the last, we can see the clearly shear bands are visible in the last image. And also with the progression, we see that this color coding shows the orientation of crystals, how crystals are oriented. So it is represented with the help of color coding. And we see that after deformation of 1 millimeter and 1.75 millimeter, the colors of the both the grains has been changed. So means the orientation of crystals is completely changed with the deformation. And below diagram shows the concentrated, we can say that the resultant of the picture. So we see that orientation was only two dots we are visible in the pole figure, inverse pole figure, means orientation or more or less concentrated, means same orientation is there. But with the deformation, we see the scattering in this triangle that is called inverse pole figure. So it's a indicate that material has been randomized. So initially it was like a single crystal or the same orientation was there, and with the deformation material is randomizing, so orientation is changing. But mechanical point of view, we can see that shear bands and the slip bands are visible, and how crack will initiate, that can be identified, and we can see in that. So this is important for the sheet metal industries and like automobiles and these applications. Next example is I heard.
Take it, sir. Bye.
Hello. I am audible.
Yes, sir. Hello? You are audible, sir. Please continue, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So next example is from the mechanical deformation that is called rolling. That we all know that rolling, forging. So in the case of rolling. So these three images shows that 40% deformed. So we see that grains are equist or say slightly elongated because it is already 40% deformed. But initially it was equist grain. And with the deformation, we see that 80% has completely bended formation. So grains has been like a rolling band. So we can see that rolling bands a formation in the grains. So with the rolling, grains are crushed and formed a band. So this enhance the mechanical properties of the sheet metal. So in case of automobiles, we have seen that there are two type of coils are coming, hot rolled coil and cold rolled coils. So in case of a hot rolling, initially we are rolling the material when it is hot. So simultaneously recovery is taking place. So that much bending is not forming because crystals are recrystallizing and forming the again during the rolling and due to heating. But in the case of the cold rolling, there is complete crushing and which enhance the mechanical properties. So hardness and other properties are improved. So most of the automobiles are used for the cold rolled samples and means cold rolled coils after heat treatment. And second one, we see that the after the heat treatment of 32 hours below image. So some small grains are forming in the top image and same area has been observed. So it's showing that some small grains are fragmented due to the recovery process. So material is recovering at the after 32 hours heating at the material at the 600 degree centigrade. And this study is a classical example of single crystal because there are very few selected materials which are single crystalline in nature. Because most of the practical materials which we are dealing, whether it is aluminium, steel, all these are polycrystalline in nature. And this is one of the example that material is CRGO, cold rolled grain oriented electrical steel. So that material is used in the transformer core. And unfortunately, so far in India, we are not able to produce it. So this all material is procured from outside India. Recently, I think there is one MOU with the JSW and JFE Japan. Maybe they are trying to start it again. And hopefully maybe production started in India. So this material is a CRGO, cold rolled grain oriented. So it shows the single color because earlier we said that multiple color, which means there were different orientations. So this single color shows the single orientation. So crystals have only one orientation. And this material, we have done the study in different directions like rolling direction, 45 to rolling direction and 90 degree to rolling direction. And mechanical tests were performed on the same sample in the three different directions. And result are, we can see that there are completely different result we have obtained. in the rolling direction RD0. We see 0%, 3% and 4%. There is hardly some changes coming. Same in the case of RD90, there is no significant change. But in case of RD45, we see that is after 3% deformation, localized shear band is formed and material ruptured at 4% of the elongation. While in case of RD0 and RD90, there is no change. Just for the visualization, we see that the right side image, which shows that different crystals has been represented on the samples, that is pink and green, this one, right side image. So we see that crystals are completely rotating. So these indicate that complete rotation of the crystals during the deformation in the tensile test. And for the basic understanding, because we have discussed the many microstructures and these things, so I just put up the slide. So starting from the right side, it is the process of solidification. This side, a material is in liquid form and crystals are starting, the formation of crystals is there. And during the cooling, the crystals attach to each other and they started a cluster. And this process continue and this combine the entire area. And whenever there is a change in the orientation, so this figure I wanted to show to explain the grain boundary. What is a grain boundary? So here we see that crystals are forming and they, during the cooling, crystals formation and enhancing. But when there is a deviation of the one orientation to the another orientation, that is called misorientation. And when this misorientation form a continuous loop, that is called grain boundary. So here we see that a complete formation of the grain boundaries. So different grain boundaries are formed and complete structure. So that was the starting from the right side to the left side. Just a minute, one call is coming. Just one. Hello. Sorry for interrupt. So starting again from the left side, we see. So left side, we see that the material which we observed in the optical microscope. So in optical microscope, we see this kind of structure. And in the case of the electron microscope, we can observe that different kind of orientations we can get. So these orientations are nothing but different crystals, how crystals are aligned in a material. So optical we have seen, and going to the at submicrostructure level, we see that different planes I have shown. So if you want to study different planes, because now we have discussed that a grain and a microstructures, and if we go to sub study like at the level of the planes, so different planes study we can perform by using the crystallographic diffraction. So next topic we are discussing with the X-ray diffraction. So here we see that this setup is for the X-ray diffraction. This is XRD machine. And here, as all we are aware that we have gone for the medical X-ray. So it's a similar kind of a X-ray. Means X-ray is same, but intensity and the nature of X-ray is scattered in the case of medical, because you want to cover the whole body or that whole area. But in case of the material characterization, material study, what we do in that case, we penetrate the X-ray, or we can say that it's a more concentrated X-ray is utilized so that it can penetrate slightly into the material and get the some information of the crystallographic planes. So this one is the setup of a X-ray diffraction machine, and this equipment utilizes the X-ray. So by using the X-ray diffraction, we get the superimposed that whenever there is a constructive interference, we will get this peak. So we see that 111 peak, 200 peak, 220, 311 and 222 like that. So different peaks are formed. So this shows that we have covered the range from 0 to 100 degree. Means we are keeping the sample at the center and then rotating the X-ray in the different directions. Or either we can say that we are rotating the sample, or either we can say we are rotating the detector and the source. One of the things we can keep constant, and because different orientations machines are coming. By utilizing this, we can study the crystallographic texture Second one is residual stress, and third one is peak profile, that is phase analysis. So here we see that a schematic diagram to show the texture and non-texture. So CRG is showing that this image, small crystals are oriented in the same direction, while in case of the second image, crystals are oriented in the random directions. So this material has more or less same property in all directions, while above image CRG has the different property in different directions. So the next one is crystallographic texture analysis. How we can study the crystallographic texture? So crystallographic texture is nothing but it's a, we can say, representation, orientation of the crystals, how crystals are oriented inside the material. For example, the third image we see starting, so it's showing the different precipitates are visible on the surface. So it is morphological texture, it is not a crystallographic texture. But image A and image B shows that crystallographic texture, how crystals are oriented. So first image shows that crystals are oriented in different directions, that is randomly oriented, like a heap of bricks, we can say. But when we arrange the bricks in a same pattern, so then it shows that it's coming in the same pattern and it's showing the texture. So that is called textured material. Material with crystallographic texture. And there are two different orientations, so that a sample may be cylindrical or it can be like that a rectangular sample. So these two different representation are utilized. So representation with the Miller indices in the sheet and the wire. For example, there are wire, so that have the different orientation, and sheet we have different orientation, so we can represent with this. This image showed that how we can represent the texture. So from point A, we take the projection. At the center, there is a sample, and we take the projection on a spherical area and taking a plane parallel to that surface of the sample, and plane normal we are plotting. On the plane normal, these three dots are forming. That is for the single crystal. And below image shows the polycrystal. We have seen the different dots are coming on this sphere. So this means that crystals are oriented in the different directions, and we are getting the different orientations on that. So far we have discussed the crystallographic texture representation and measurement part. And next measurement we can do with the X-ray diffraction is residual stress analysis. So residual stress is nothing but it's a stress inside the material when there is no external load is applied on the material. So when there is a body which is stationary and equilibrium in with its surrounding, inside that there are some stresses at the crystal levels, that is called residual stress. So this schematic diagram shows that the one perfect image, and with the imperfection imposed, some deviation is coming in the crystals, and due to that some tension and compression is coming in the nearby crystals. So that localized stress is called residual stress. This is one of the examples. Suppose there are two plates, A and B plates. And if we apply some load, some elongation delta E is given on the sample A and B. If these both are independent, there is a no relation. So yeah, one can move in other direction. So A will be in stress zero and B will be in stress. But when it's a combined structure, then there will be some stress of the different natures. So A will be in the tension or B will be in compression. So two different kind of stress will come. So this is same kind of mechanism take place at the microstructure level at the crystals. So one plane is coming in the tension, another plane is coming in the compression. So resultant there will be some tension or compression stress will be there on the material. So that stress is remains in the material even though there is no external load is applied. And these stresses are sometimes useful and sometimes harmful as per requirement of the applications. For example, if we apply some compressive stress on the surface of a sheet or this thing, so it means it's compressing the surface, so crack formation will be delayed. But while there is a tensile stress is there on the like, so this application more or less is utilized for the bearing, ball bearings. So in the ball bearings, they do the short pinning to apply some compressive stress on the surface so that there should not be any crack initiation. And below diagram shows that the different grains and how residual stress can vary inside a grain or in between the grains. Next one, I have included the mechanical properties. So correlation of the mechanical properties. So in case of mechanical properties, I have selected the tensile test, simple one. So it shows the stress strain diagram. So sometime in question arise that how stress strain diagram for a brittle material like glass, it will be. So it is like a brittle one. So it is a complete brittle. So there will be no elongation, complete ductile deformation is not there. So material will be in elastic, slightly deviate from its position and it fracture. So there is no elongation. In case of B, we see that a ductile material at room temperature. C curve show the ductile at the high temperature. When there is a slightly higher temperature, material is ductile. It will show higher elongation, but strength will be less because of the high temperature. This is one of the example of the aluminium alloy, which was deformed 53 times, I mean 53 times the initial value. So it is the one of the super plastic, we can say that in range it's going. That much elongation we can get in the aluminium with the different strain rate and combination of the thermomechanical processing. And in case of material, we see that there is a fracture and shear. How we define fracture and shear in terms of a microstructure or say mechanical properties correlation. So in the right side image, we see that shear bends. So showing three lines on the grains. And if you visualize and zoom it, it shows the deformations like A, B, A, C. So these bends are formations. So these grains are fracturing and dislocations are moving. So these dislocations move and these are the dislocation boundaries which are formed. And inside a grain, if we zoom and we see, these are the dislocations. So these dislocations imparted in the material and movement of this enhance the failure or the things. And also sometimes we see that there is no failure, but there is some mechanical deformation. So these dislocations increase the hardness of material. Below diagram shows that again that CRGO, tensile test mechanical properties, that earlier I told the three different directions show the different properties. So this is the stress strain diagram of CRGO material in three different directions. So this is strategy which shows that 110 and direction is 111, that is a rolling 45 degree. So 45 to rolling degree, it shows the fracture at the 3% of the elongation. While in case of a rolling direction, it's showing to 6-7%. And in the transverse direction, it's going to 12%. And similarly, that's again same diagram I represented. How in 45 direction crystals rotated and enhance the fracture at the early stage of the 2% or 3%. So by studying these crystallographic texture, we can identify. Otherwise, we have to find out what is the reason why material fails at 2% or 3% in the 45 direction. So what is the reason behind that? So with the advanced characterization technique, we can find out the reason the why material failed at the 45 degree and it's not failing in the other direction. Because of the crystals, rotation is happening in that direction and that enhance the failure. Slip bands are activated in that direction, while that bands are not activated in the case of the rolling 90 degree. This one is another example which shows that during the yielding, what happens? We have seen that at the yield point, there is a drop in the strength of the material. We see that upper yield point and lower yield point. In the mechanical we have seen. So what is happening at the yield point? So this study is clearly represent softening of the material at the yield point. So this we have measured in term of microstructure. So from microstructure we calculate the grain boundary and misorientations. So misorientation and grain boundary indicate the strength of the material. When there is a higher grain boundary or higher misorientations, means there is a more deformation. But when there is a reduction in the grain boundary and misorientations, that is only happens during the recrystallization or annealing of the samples, means heating. During heating, these are the annealation of boundary take place. But in this case, we have observed that at the yield point, misorientation and grain boundaries are dropping. So this clearly indicates the softening of material. Also, it was verified with the magnetic properties. Because it was a slightly different from the theoretical analysis, because in as per theoretical, when material is deforming, there should be some increase in the misorientation. But in this case, there was a drop. So this was verified with the magnetic properties. So in case of magnetic properties, seriously loss also coming down. So this is in line with the observed microstructure studies. So we have completed two studies so far, that is microstructure and axial diffraction crystallographic analysis. And coming to the third type of technique, that is thermogrammetric analysis. So this thermogrammetric analysis is thermal analysis of the materials, means at what temperature materials is melting, because in the thermomechanical or thermodynamics we are studying that melting temperature, recrystallization temperature. But how to identify the melting, recrystallization temperature or phase change temperature, these techniques. So this is one of the equipment. So this equipment is equipped with a very precise balance. It measures the weight of the sample and it has a sealed furnace. Inside the furnace, sample is heated and continuously precise balance measures the weight of the sample. So when we heat the sample, there is change in the weight of the sample due to some evaporation or some absorption of the moisture or release of moisture, or depending on the equation, whether it is endothermic or exothermic reaction, we can find out these different properties. So right side graph shows that some drop in the weight, and there are 1, 2, 3 drop in the weight. So at what particular temperature, what is the weight loss, we can identify, and it means some gases are evolved. So there is a one technique called FTIR. So we can transmit the evolved gases to the FTIR, Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. By using that technique, we can characterize the evolved gases. So what are the gases evolved during the heating, at what particular temperature? So we get to know that which element are evaporating, or whether it is oxidizing, or what is the composition of the gases evolved. So this is one of the technique by which we can characterize the melting point, recrystallization, weight loss during heating, and temperature of the phase changes. So this study can be performed and can be utilized for the various kind of, and more or less this study is most stable for the polymer kind of materials, because polymer has the lower melting point, like cable insulation and rubber tires. So these kind of materials are at the lower melting temperature, and different evolved gases and a deviation due to heat, because the environmental effect is also applicable on that polymer part. So that characterization is applicable. Second one, coming to the FTIR and spectrometer for the chemical composition. So FTIR is a Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. So this image shows that this is a chamber. Inside the chamber, we can put the gas, solid or powder sample, or also we can utilize the liquid sample. All the three state of sample can be characterized by using this equipment. So this shows that a spectrometer, one of the spectra, and there is one library, the standard library is there. With that, we can match, search and match, and we can identify the composition of the materials. And below, which showing that the standard chemical composition analysis, that is spectrometer. So in both the equipments, difference is that is utilized for the polymer, and this is more or less metallic, because it required the conductivity spectrometer, because it's based on the spark based technique. So sample and electrode, there will be spark, and based on the spectrum of the light, it identify the element of the material. So with this, we have covered the different technique of the technique part, which we can identify the different materials, or we can characterize the materials, or microstructure analysis part. So first, I was asked to discuss some opportunity after engineering. So that part we can discuss, or if you have some question from the technical part, that we can discuss now. Hello. Is there anyone have any question on technical part, or any clarity is required, or we can move to the next part?
No questions, sir. All clear.
Okay. So I'm just moving to the next part, that is discussing some opportunities after engineering. So most of the students select the engineering as a career. The first question come in mind that why engineering? So some says that parents have suggested this profession is better. Some says that I'm not getting the cutoff for the medical lines. And some of us, we select because of our challenge, curiosity, excitement, and maybe some have money, travel or status reason, or entrepreneurship or job in a big. So that decision, sometimes students take and sometimes it was imposed by parents or some influence. But my experience is that whatever was the reason to join that engineering as a profession, whenever we come to this profession, so this profession is so vast that we required the people with the different skills, different set of knowledge. So in the box also, I mentioned that engineering is a field that requires many people with different skill to work together in a simplified way. So my suggestion is that no need to think about that why we came or why are what we are doing. Engineering is a profession where all kind of person, all kind of students or all kind of say, knowledge skills can be accommodated, because in industry, we required the different student with different knowledge. Some have the academic knowledge, some have leadership knowledge, some have management knowledge. So different knowledge are required in this field. But main thing is, how do you define the success? So for the success, we have to think that what is our goal, and if we are achieving that goal, means we are successful. So what is our target? So the target point and our goal decide the success. That depends on the person to person, and that varies. So in case of initial, we need to set goal. So first, try to fix up your goal depending on your interest, in which field you want to go. You want to go in the designing field, you want to go in production, quality. Depending on that, we have to fix up our goal and metrics. Suppose someone is in good in sports, he can also try for that. Different leadership positions are there, so that is also one of the helpful position, and with that academic requirement is fulfilling. But keep in mind that no single formula for the success. We have to work continuously. There is improvement is required. And one famous quote is there: don't make all mistake yourself. Learning from others' error is much better. So that is one of the things we have to learn from the BTech time itself, and also need to implement in the social life or say our general life. We have to think that what's happening in our life and what is happening in surrounding. So whatever the surroundings or whatever experience we are getting from the college life, we need to learn from that and avoid our mistakes. So in the continuum that no matter what it is, become best in world. It means that you have to select one field and be master of that field. Plan for the 2-3 years to get really comfortable and productive in that field. Suppose if someone has the interest in the designing, so you can go for the AutoCAD, CATIA, PROE, and depth, go into depth and be master of that field. For example, if you go into production and these things, so be comfortable with the different statics analysis, Excel sheets, production related technique. So these specify your goal and these things, and take the target of 2-3 years and develop your skill. Work as hard as you can. You are setting your own reputation and trajectory. This one started from whenever you take the admission in BTech. Only top performer have the choice to option for the next job, or you can say the first offer of the placement. Find your mentor and role model, which can guide you, which may be your teacher, which may be your senior, which may be your alumnus. So any of your, maybe your family members. So make the role model and follow them. Next, coming to the first job, most of us, the student, have the doubt like that which job we should take, whether we take the campus placement or not, or maybe that better company is coming, we may not get that. That kind of doubt are there. So in that case, I want to suggest that take the best available option. Whatever option you are getting, take that. Don't waste time for the betterment. So in the starting, whatever option you are getting for the job, select from that, whichever best option is available, take that option, because after that you can change and you can enhance your knowledge, because this is a basic knowledge we are getting from BTech. And after that, when we go to industry, in industry we need to work in a practical manner, because in the theoretical we are getting knowledge in BTech or CBE or laboratory knowledge we are getting, but scale of that production or knowledge is different. And also keep in mind there are different other options are there, entrepreneurship and PSU, MNC, government sector job, different jobs are available. But depending on the interest, we need to decide which is best suited to us. For example, I have written two lines. If you want to earn money and live fast, then go for MBA or MS. And if someone want respect and live peacefully, then you can go for MTech and PhDs. So these are slightly different in management and technological or say academic job. That is some difference. But keep in mind that don't let your dream to down. Be motivated and try to obtain whatever you want. So next one, I will go one by one. Different options you can try. What are the options after BTech we can have? So first one is campus placement. Try your best to get the job at campus placement, because it's easy and at the doorstep we can get placement, so it's beneficial. To get placement, we need to keep in mind that we have to maintain a good CGPA record, prepare for job interview, take part in extra activity, study the company, whichever is, company is coming for the campus placement. So study the profile of that company, what are the product of the company and what is revenue, these kind of things you study, so that it will be better for aligning your knowledge as per the requirement of company. Next option is higher studies. One of the most popular career option after engineering is to pursue for higher studies. So BTech student can go for the MTech and PhD. So this is one I wanted to discuss. After BTech, we can give the GATE exam, and based on the GATE exam, we can get the admission in the MTech in NIIT or IITs. Also, there is an option like I did, that is option for the direct PhD after BTech. So after PhD, after BTech, we can go for direct PhD. That is also based on the GATE exam. Based on the GATE exam, we can apply for the PhD position. So nowadays, PhD scholars are also getting a good amount of the scholarship. And after that, we can settle in a good institute or company. One major difference is that we see that a higher cutoff is required for the MTech. But in case of PhD admission, there are a slightly separate mode of selection in the IITs. We can apply for the GATE exam. Based on the GATE exam, if we see 90 percentile we are getting, or say 85% we are getting, there is a chances to get a call from the different IITs, even we are getting 85 percentile. Or say 80%. So above 80 percentile, we can get a call. After that, we will have an interview and written test may be applicable depending on the candidates. So this is a one of the entry in the IIT we can get after the BTech, even though we have slightly lower score of the GATE. That is one of the option. And giving the GATE example, that GATE exam, that is beneficial for getting the public sector services, that is PSUs. Most of the PSUs are taking the new recruiting joining based on the GATE exams. So there is a GATE criteria, means GATE score. Depending on GATE score, they call the students for the new joining. So different PSUs are there, that like ONGC is there, NTPC is there, Power Grid, GAIL, Coal India, Container Corporation of India Limited. So if we search in the Google also, we can see that there are many PSUs. So maybe that 30-40 PSUs are there, which are good. Number of PSUs may be 100, but 30-40 companies are very good companies. And every year they have vacancies. Earlier, these vacancies are filled through the campus placement of IITs. But from few years, it has been stopped from the Supreme Court that only IITs students were getting the option to go into PSUs. So now the scenario has been changed. So now they are taking the student from the open based on the GATE exam. So you can go for different advertisement on the Google and apply for that. These are the good job for PSU. And next one is management position. So whoever want to go into management position, that can pursue the MBA. That is one of the preferred course. But MBA has that common aptitude test. We can get CAT or MAT, and different categories are there for the admissions. So based on the CAT, we can get the admission in the MBA management courses. And studying management is a higher paying job with more responsibility. So that earlier also I have explained that difference between the M.Tech and MBA and PhDs. So depending on that, this knowledge, which is stable to you, you can select one of the examination and get your desired. And next, coming to the be an expert of a field. Nowadays, there are many requirements in the industries which required a specific knowledge. Earlier, it was like that only mechanical, computer science, these branches were there. Nowadays, the new branches are coming like that: data science, blockchain, artificial intelligence, machine learning, digital marketing, design, advanced designs are coming. So select one of the dedicated course. These most of the courses are nowadays online. Also, we can get the certificate from the NPTEL, and other institute are giving these courses. So these are the short-term courses, like 3-month course, 6-month course, 1-month course. And some IITs already started the BSc and BTech in data science. And also they are giving the certification course of the 3-month and 6-month. So these additional knowledge will also be helpful for like going to the industry. So this specific requirement can be fulfilled. Next one is coming to entrepreneurship. Only difference in entrepreneurship and regular job is that entrepreneurship required a particular idea with the problem, and you have to come up with the solution. Entrepreneurship is a long-term process. Sometime you have to go take the patience, but experience of starting with running a new company is priceless. So for example, it's a initial, if we are discussing at the BTech level, so it's quite difficult for the entrepreneurship, but if there is a, some idea which can be converted into useful product, then it is a worth to go for entrepreneurship. For example, the Flipkart, it was also 2-3 friends, they formulated the Flipkart, and they moved hassle-free shopping of the offline. Similar, one of the idea was Paytm solve the problem of the cash scarcity. So this depends on the idea, which idea you are taking and how you are solving that problem. Depending on, you can select the entrepreneurship. And next option after BTech, we can go for civil services. Civil services are among the hottest career option. So public service commission civil service exam is there. So it has the two part. One is preliminary examination and mains examination, written and interview. So in my opinion, after BTech, everyone should at least give a chance to this one. And also see that in 2016, most of the toppers in the CSE examination were engineers, and higher rankers will get a good position in the civil services. Next one is to join the Indian Armed Forces. So these are the different armed forces in India: Army, Air Force, and Naval. So these test schemes are there. One of the test scheme can be selected, and we can try for that. Students should apply in that. And there are good opportunity in the Indian Army, Air Force, and Navy after the BTech, because there are technical branches and technical courses are there in which we can serve. If there is a no possibility in the above, then we have to come, most of the student may be going to this field. So this one is coming to next one is looking for the internship. Getting job is nowadays quite difficult. So if we are getting option of internship, we should select that option. And we have to take that option. And during internship, there is a different chances. And we get to know that work culture of the company, how work is going in the industry. Based on that, to different company, and then chances of selection is very much. After that, next option I have selected is that entry in the private sector. That is the main focus we are discussing today, because most of the student or most of the engineering graduate are going to this field, because this field has a vast opportunity for the accommodating new graduates. So either we can get through the campus placement, that is excellent. If there is no campus placement, we are not getting chance. And also nowadays pandemic, so maybe it's difficult. So there is no need to worry. I have seen that my various many friends are there, and also new students. So different industry are there nearby, like including NCR, Pune, Gujarat, Bangalore. So in these city we can go, and we have to try walking in small companies. There are various companies, because in big company entry will be difficult, but small company we can, with the available person resources, that this is my qualification and it's matching with your job, so we have to take that job. We can take that. We can also take the help of online portals. We can register our resume, and there are different options for the jobs that I practically have seen that many of my contact have got the call from different sources. Also, there are some options in the NCR or say that industrial hub. There are some good consulting firm. They provide the resources, there's manpower to the industry, they have contact. So in that we can take the help of them, because we don't know what are the vacancies available in which company. But they people have contact and they know that these are the vacancies. Some genuine consulting firm are also there. They have database of the industries and requirement of the manpower. We can go and we can submit a resume. Whenever there is a requirement, they give a call back that this is a requirement in that company with this desired qualification skill set, and this can be tried. So this is one of the best option I've seen, that many of the students are getting this option. So in conclusion, I can say that in engineering, there are various opportunities are available. So no need to worry that nowadays there pandemic and campus placement may be down or some student this one, but overall there is in this scenario, most of the vacancies are coming and we can get the options in the different companies. So with this, I have done with the presentation. Thank you. If we have any question, we can discuss in the technical or that industrial part or job opportunities.
Thank you, Satish.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And thanks to all my dear students and colleagues. And I will surely acknowledge for giving me direction and my students in the field of crystallography, TBSD, a new term we taught to the students, shear band and slip band, and PGA, and so much of good application part of calculation. This is good. And also you have given a very nice platform to understand why the mechanical engineering students can seek their job and how they can shape their career. I am very much impressed with your knowledge. And my students, you can ask, and anytime you can reach to him. He is your very senior and very can guide you in all aspect of life. And I hope we'll be meeting, and probably whenever we'll go for offline classes, definitely I will call him face to face. We can interact, and in the present time is very unhealthy. Because of that, we are in the closed room. Naveen, I can see you. And I hope everybody is safe and everybody's family is safe with this safety norms. And I am also just came out with the exposed COVID. And Satish too has come out with this. And surely we will come out with this pandemic. And later we can definitely go for shaping of career and other aspects. Till then, we will continue to share our knowledge and grow in the field of technology.
Yes, sir.
Anything students can ask, most welcome, most welcome.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Today I discussed in brief because at work from home we are doing, and detail we can also discuss with the different topics. And I also, you can approach me because I did BTech from BRCM College of Engineering, and after that I did a PhD. So TIT and BRCM, there is a close relation. So as a senior also, you can contact me. You can discuss any matter of the regarding the technical or non-technical. I am always available. And in this topic, whatever we discussed, if anyone have question, we can have question also.
So I hope people have enjoyed a lot. And I really feel that for the first year students, things will be little a new one, but other students, second year, third year, final year students, they might have heard about this structural understanding, functional properties, and so on. So nothing to worry, you will also learn, and it's we have opened the opportunities for you. So with this, can we close the webinar today for?
Yes, sir. Thank you, okay. Sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, dear friends. And
thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.